Welcome everyone. Hello, my name's Alice Baxter. I'm from BBC One. I hope you all hear me. So today we are discussing the topic of European security and defence policy. Now, since since 2008, Europe has endured its deepest post-war economic crisis. Some argue that the European Union and its very existence can no longer be taken as a given, an issue uppermost in the minds of people in this country is a very public and divisive battle that's currently being played out within our own coalition government. But in this session, and in the following session this afternoon, we'll be exploring some of the most important ways in which Europe has, as a collective and mostly unified whole, worked together and continues to move towards a stated goal of even greater cohesion. So firstly, in this particular session, we're focusing on the EU's policy on security and defence. Now, the project of developing an independent European Security and Defence Policy, or ESDP, as I'll be shortening it to, was launched by the Cologne European Council back in 1999 as a distinctive part of the EU's common foreign and security policy. Now, the aim of ESDP is to complete and strengthen the EU's external ability to act in the international arena through the development of civilian and military capabilities for international conflict prevention and crisis management. However, the ESDP is still operating with a degree of incoherence and, predominantly, according to some, under the shadow of NATO. Now, in 2011, the decision by the UK and France to intervene in Libya under the NATO framework highlighted the divisions within the EU as they struggled to reach a unified decision on the action, as well as underlining the need for modern systems and facilities. As such, it accelerated the debate on how best to make the European security and defence policy more effective. Well, it's a theme recently reiterated by NATO Secretary Rasmussen and also by the President of the European Council, Herman Van Rompuy, who both warned against the dangers of uncoordinated budget cuts in times of economic crisis. Indeed, NATO has said that the Arab Spring underlined the urgency for Europe to rebalance its defence spending with the United States to reduce its reliance on NATO and equip itself with capabilities deemed to be, and in the words of Rasmussen here, critical, deployable and sustainable, and must demonstrate political determination to achieve that goal. So a lot for us and our UK coalition government members to pick through. And today we're going to be looking particularly at some of the most radical changes that are taking place in the evolution of the ESDP. And we ask, are we working towards a European Union defence policy possibly? We'll also be looking at the EU common defence policy from a NATO perspective, and the issue of a single market for EU defence industries and the possibility of new European police organisations to guard the Union's external borders and its impact on the EU's relations with its neighbours. So a lot there. Well, joining me on the stage, I'm very happy to welcome Eva Gross. Eva is a senior analyst at the European Union Institute of Security Studies. She holds a PhD from the London School of Economics and has been a visiting fellow at the Centre for Transatlantic Relations, the Paul H. Nitzsche School of Advanced International Studies and the Johns Hopkins University. She's a former editor of Millennium, that's a journal of international studies, and a former associate production manager at the European Journal of International Relations. She's also taught at the EU in the Department of International Relations. I'm also joined by Senator Colm Burke. Mr. Burke has been a member of the Irish Senate since April 2011. Previously, he was a member of the European Parliament for the Ireland South constituency between 2007 and 2009, and served on various EP committees, including the Foreign Affairs Committee. He was also a member of Cork City Council and was Lord Mayor of Cork back in 2003 to 2004. Welcome to you both. And if I could first open the floor to Eva Gross.
Okay, thanks very much, Alice, for this kind of introduction. Thank you for inviting me here today. I think what I'm going to say is going to follow logically in a way from the panel we had before lunch on the common foreign and security policy, of which obviously defense is a part. We touched on the effects of austerity already, but I think there's a real sense when it comes to the defense aspect as part of the foreign policy package in a way that the EU is really, not just the EU, but also Europe is standing at a crossroads. between sort of irrelevance, not being able to maintain or defend its own interests. And I think it's a result of this sort of pull factors that move away from integration. And one of them is the threat to European cohesion as a result of individual member states pulling away from Europe, much as Britain, much as for inter-European reasons, but also as a result of austerity as well. I think many member states are sort of reconsidering what Europe can deliver, what it means for them, what the basis of their commitment to Europe is. I think my own country, Germany, is one of the few exceptions in that list. But so you have a sort of general discussion of where Europe is headed as a project in the middle of an austerity spell that makes convincing European publics, but also politicians, to spend on security and defense policy, and to have even discussions on foreign policy interests quite limited. So in this space, this debate over what we want Europe to be able to do in security defense is diminishing, and it's sort of hard to even be pragmatic about it. I think that's one of the way forward, but I think there's also a real sense that what's needed now is not just pragmatism, but in a way also the next big idea and the next big push, or maybe even a crisis to move us back towards a commitment to a European foreign security and defense policy. That's also a function of political leadership, of course. And when we look at, and I think this sort of pull away from Europe and defense in general on the part of European countries is troubling also because we're not getting any safer. If you look at the sort of strategic environment in which we are, in which we're forcing to operate, the challenges aren't getting any less. We have, you mentioned the Arab Spring, but we have instability in the neighborhood. We have an increasing incidence of failed or failing states that force migration, that sort of encourage or harbor terrorism. All sorts of non-traditional transnational security threats that Europe will have to deal with. Not necessarily by military means, but military is part of the arsenal of measures with which to counter these potential threats. But what's even more troubling or more difficult to grapple with, I think, intellectually also, is that these threats in the neighborhood and beyond are taking place against the backdrop of a sort of global power shift that sees the rise of China and India, just to the biggest one. And it's not quite clear what sort of role, influence, and capabilities the West collectively will have in managing these new challenges, and what role these new players will play in these sort of security challenges. So in that context, the shortfalls and capabilities that we experience in Europe are all that make all the more troublesome in a way, because we know it's not getting any safer. We're not really sure yet how that's going to hit us in a way. But we're also quite keenly aware that we're not really doing very much on overcoming or preventing or preempting, even thinking about potential responses to these challenges. And I think the topic of European defense, we talked about foreign policy in the last panel, and I thought the panelists in the discussion were a bit hard on foreign policy. I think the EU does have a fairly active foreign policy. But when it comes to European defense policy, it's true that the shortcomings of the EU as a security actor are perhaps the most blatant. That doesn't mean that the EU isn't active in security and defense-related matters. I mean, when you look at the number and nature of CSDP missions, CSDP is the Common Security and Defense Policy, there have been and there continue to be a number of missions being launched that involve European personnel, whether it's a training mission in Mali, a training mission in Somalia, or peacekeeping missions in Bosnia. So Europeans are still putting troops on the ground. But when it comes to creating capabilities, there remains a lack of investment and a lack of engagement on how we could improve that. That's of course because, I mean, the EU remains an intergovernmental structure when it comes to security and defense policy, so we're basically looking at 27 member states with different strategic cultures, different perceptions, different preferences for addressing them, so even finding a common denominator there can lowest common denominator is going to be difficult. So it's a challenge we have to face. And the sense of crisis or an impasse having been reached on this sort of question is also sort of obvious in a way, or has caused the EU, let's say, to call for a discussion on capabilities on the European security defense policy in the upcoming December Council, in a way to force member states to kickstart the debate, to come up with some idea on how to move European defense forward. And of course, capabilities, they are playing a huge role in making you competitive in the new security environment. We touched on that a little bit also on the last panel. I just wanted to plug one of a product of my institute. We actually did do a study on European capabilities, and it's called Enabling the Future. It will be launched tomorrow officially, but it's already available on our website. I read it on the train here this morning. I found it very fascinating, and when I came here, I saw that the rapporteur of this report, James Rogers, is actually sitting here. So I'm not going to repeat what's in the report, but if you're interested, if it comes up in discussion, maybe James, you want to plug in the debate. But again, in the last panel, we touched on pooling and sharing, and the difficulty in getting member states to integrate their approach to defense. Mm-hmm. What two of the panelists mentioned, I mean, and again the report proposes several avenues of increasing capabilities, of getting at this pooling and sharing. But what's already happening, of course, is sort of regional cooperation, the Franco-British alliance, sort of Nordic cooperation. So you do have incidences of member states coming together and cooperating in individual issue areas. The issue there, I would say, though, is that unless that's integrated in a broader European conversation and a coordination effort,